everybody. I am Dave Karger. Hello, everyone. I'm Dave Karger, the chief correspondent at Fandango. I am so happy here as your host for this official live stream of the red carpet premiere of The Hobbit, The Desolation of Smaug. I'm going to be talking to all of the cast members as they make their way down this. Well, actually, it's a black carpet, if we're going to be factual about the whole thing. We're not going to call it a red carpet tonight. It's the black and gold carpet premiere of The Hobbit, The Desolation of Smaug. Many of the cast members are going to be here tonight. Martin Freeman, Benedict Cumberbatch, Evangeline Lilly, Luke Evans, Orlando Bloom, and of course, the director himself, Peter Jackson. It's going to get very exciting here for the next hour and 15 minutes or so. We're going to have all of the action on the carpet here for you live. And it's a very long carpet, so I am fortunate to have with me my lovely co-host, Amy Paffrath. She's across the street. Amy, what's going on where you are?
I am in the middle of all these excited fans, as you can see. They came here to see their favorite stars from The Hobbit, and I'm going to be bringing some of them in to ask their favorite stars questions about the film. I've also got this handy-dandy tablet, so if you couldn't make it to Hollywood night tonight, not to worry. I'm going to be able to read your questions as well from all around the globe. So be sure to hashtag Hobbit Premiere. That'll be pulled up right in my fingertips, and we'll be able to ask your questions as well. And be sure to let us know where you're watching from. We want to make this a global interactive event. So you guys are running the show tonight. The stars are arriving. They're running across the street, dodging traffic to come say hello to the fans. We're going to be bringing it to you all night over the next hour or so. Dave, what's going on over there?
Well, I was looking at some of the camera work that our colleagues have going on, and I think I saw Richard Armitage, who plays Thorin Oakenshield. I think I saw him arrive. I think Manu Bennett is here, too, who plays Azog, the lead orc. It's very cool to see what he actually looks like, because you don't really get to see his face when you see the movies. I can tell you I was lucky enough, Amy, to see this movie yesterday.
I'm so jealous, by the way.
I know, and you should.
But I did see Manu up close. He is a gorgeous man.
Yeah, exactly.
I can attest to that.
I can tell you that the fans of The Hobbit and Lord of the Rings are not going to be disappointed when they see this one. I really enjoyed this film. I fell right in to the world that Peter Jackson creates. There are so many terrific action sequences in this film. I think a lot of people have seen some footage and some of the clips that they've released of this great sequence where a lot of the dwarves are riding down this river in some barrels, and it is extremely exciting. I think that's one sequence that people are going to be talking about a lot. And in fact, Manu Bennett is actually arriving on the red carpet. You see him right there. If you don't recognize him, it's because, as Amy and I were saying, he plays the main orc, the Defiler, and he's almost unrecognizable when you see him because he looks so different. So I'm sure he actually is happy to show his face. People do know him from the TV show Spartacus, but I think people who are fans of The Hobbit might not necessarily recognize him. Now, before we start talking to some of the stars as they down, Amy, I have something really cool to tell you about, which is that earlier today, an Air New Zealand Boeing 777-300 made its way to Los Angeles Airport here in LA, and on this plane is actually something very exciting, which is a 942 square meter graphic emblazoned on the side of the actual aircraft of the character of Smaug, the dragon from this film. You can see them putting it on as you're watching this footage. And this is the first time that fans of The Hobbit have been able to see what this character looks like. And the people who work in the digital effects house, Weta Digital, they actually had to create this image from scratch because no still picture of this character actually existed. Now, New Zealand, of course, is home to the landscapes that characterize The Hobbit movies. New Zealand is not only well established as the home of Middle Earth, but Air New Zealand is also the official airline of Middle Earth. But Middle Earth is actually closer than you think. It's only a 12-hour flight from here to Middle Earth. And this airplane emblazoned with Smaug on it will take to the skies on a regular basis, either flying from Los Angeles to London, England, or Los Angeles to Auckland, New Zealand. And interestingly, this is the second time that Air New Zealand has put characters from the Hobbit movies on one of their planes. Last year, when the first Hobbit film came out, An Unexpected Journey, they put together another plane with other characters from the film. So I think it's a very cool thing. Obviously, everybody anybody who is from New Zealand and works in the film industry in New Zealand is very proud of the fact that these films were made there, and also a lot of the cast members are from New Zealand. So I think it's something that, as a country, they're very proud of. You can see some of Peter Jackson and some of his colleagues there actually on the plane helping to christen it this morning as it arrived at LAX. So I think that's one thing that you'll see when this movie is coming out. And by the way, it comes out next Friday, the 13th of December. There's so many different marketing tie-ins and so many people excited about this film that it's no question that, and no surprise, that a lot of other companies are wanting to get involved in it. But as I said, I feel like the second Hobbit film is a little bit more grown up when you compare it to the first one. It's a little bit more serious, a little darker, but still extremely accessible. And all of the scenes, particularly with Smaug the dragon, who of course is voiced by Benedict Cumberbatch from Star Trek Into Darkness, those scenes are really, really exciting. There's a great long sequence with Martin Freeman, who plays Bilbo Baggins, and Smaug that I think a lot of people are going to be talking about as well. Now, we are excited to be able to show you a quick preview of The Hobbit, The Desolation of Smaug. Take a look at this footage.
We've been blind. And in our blindness, the enemy is preparing for war.
You have no right to enter that mountain.
I have the only right.
It will not end here. With every victory, this evil will grow.
Unite the armies. Together you have the might and power to retake our homeland.
There's no dishonor in turning back.
No, I think I must try.
If you waken that beast, it will destroy us all.
Hobbit, The Desolation of Smaug. In theaters December 13th. Experience it in IMAX 3D.
And we are back live on the red carpet. The stars are kind of making their way down the red carpet. I see Manu Bennett getting his photograph taken with all the paparazzi that are on the red carpet. I think it's going to get a lot crazier over the next hour or so. Let me throw it to Amy and see what's going on across the street. Amy?
To sign for the fans, to take pictures with the fans. So they're in a sweet spot. I think they were a little disappointed that the street is not blocked off, but that's not stopping anyone from literally stopping traffic to come say hello. Are you guys excited to be here tonight? Yeah! Who do you guys want to see most?
Benedict Cumberbatch.
He'll be here very soon. I'm sure you're going to get to talk to him. He, of course, is the title character of this film, the villain of this film. I can't wait to see it. I can't believe that you already got to see it. I am so jealous. It's going to be an amazing film, an amazing night. I'm going to be reading your tweets all night. Let's see what's going on social media, actually. Of course, this is from earlier today, setting up the Hobbit premiere. Too bad it's not facing us, though. It's for the press. But that's okay, because, like I said, the stars are just defying all laws of the road tonight and running across the street to meet the fans. This is going to be an amazing night. And the stars are ready. Sharon, who has a song in the film, beautiful song in the film tonight, has already arrived on the black carpet. We've got the black carpet treatment here for The Hobbit, The Desolation of Smaug, right there. Beautiful pictures. Keep sending them in, you guys. Hashtag Hobbit premiere, and I'll be able to read them off. Let's see who's tweeting us right now. Ready and waiting Hobbit premiere, Rebecca McKenzie. What's up, Rebecca? Setting up for The Hobbit premiere. Cosplay at the Hobbit premiere. We've got lots of people in character. We hope to bring some of them over to show you guys. But here's some photos that we had earlier tonight. What do you suppose is going in down there? Maybe the Hobbit premiere. It's in full swing now. I love this one. This is what Americans think of how to pronounce Smaug. It's back to Dave, because we've got celebs arriving on the carpet right now. Dave, who do you got over there?
Hey, Amy, how you doing? I've got Manu Bennett, who, as I told you, plays Azog the Defiler in the film.
He's a nice guy.
Yeah, right. You
in
might
the old
be.
World.
You know, it must be fun for you to come to an event like this, because in the movie you're hiding behind so much makeup and effects. You get to actually show your face here.
Yeah, you know, I mean, the amazing thing is, doing motion capture, I met Andy Serkis a while before they did the movie, and he told me about his experience, and it's a really amazing experience, like three times more difficult than acting, you know, because you do it with no actors there and in a very serene environment just by yourself. So, and then you got to bring it all. You got to bring all this energy into an empty set. So it's very challenging. And the great thing about coming here is I get to see how it all turns out.
Yeah. And it must be interesting for you, and people know who you are from Spartacus and other work that you've done, but Hobbit fans might not necessarily recognize you down the street unless they're the really hardcore fans, right?
You know what, Peter was really great to me in this film because he, you know, in the first film he said that I was a breakout performance, and so in this movie he's giving me my own title. You know, it's got Manu Bennett as Arzog, so I think people are going to know after this film. Yeah.
And you fight Ian McKellen. I'm not going to give too much away, but you fight Ian McKellen.
Yeah, well, you know, he's a bit of an older guy, but I didn't give him a hard time.
here's a question from social media here, from Facebook fan Marcia Sullivan Mullins. What was the most difficult scene for you to shoot?
Well, riding the wag, I'm actually on top of a pommel horse, like, you know, that you use in gymnastics. So, you know, the whole experience of being on that animal is really just about sitting on this wooden thing. So I said to Peter Jackson, I said, can I pat it? Can I stroke its fur so make more personal contact? Yeah. And you'll see that throughout the two movies, I'm always stroking the fur, but it's actually not there. It's just a pommel horse. But that was my way of making it more real for me, yeah.
Well, we've got a whole bunch of fans across the street with my co-host, Amy, and I'm sure they'd love to ask you a question. So, Amy, you got someone there?
I do have a social question. This one is, if you could live in Mirkwood, Laketown, or in Bag End, which one would you live in and why?
Well, I'd probably live in Bag End because I'd have a lot to eat.
Good answer.
You know, it's funny. So many people who live down under, I think, are so proud of the fact that you make these movies in New Zealand. Is that making it more exciting for you?
Oh, you know what? I think for Australian and New Zealanders, the last 10 years has been a really big move for our actors. You know, we're representing our culture. You know, we're representing our countries and the smaller industries that we've got in film and television. So when any one of us makes the jump, it's like a chain. You know, we're reaching back and we're pulling more through. So I'm one of the lucky ones to get across here and be working. So, you know, I just hope that more of us keep on coming over and showing what talent we've got in our own country. Yeah.
Well, I hope New Zealanders, go!
I hope you have a great time tonight. It's a pleasure to meet you. Have a lot of fun.
Thank you. Hope everyone enjoys it.
We've got so many more people arriving. I heard a couple big screams, by the way, when I was talking to Manu. Nothing against him, but I think it's because Martin Freeman showed up. He's actually on the carpet or getting ready to join the carpet. He's talking to some fans right now. I love that. It's always super fun when you see these people actually take time to spend with the fans and meet them. Of course, they're here to do interviews with people like me, but at the same time, I'm sure the people who have been waiting for so long and are so excited about this movie, they get to spend some time with them too. So, Amy, what kind of fan response are you feeling over there right now?
I am feeling electric energy over here because you are right. Martin Freeman, Bilbo Baggins himself, is right behind me signing autographs. He is, yeah, you hear everyone? They're so excited. I've got so many fans with me right now. And who do you have, Dave? I hear you have a guest with you.
Our daughter, Allie. Allie was Eleanor.
Hey, Amy, I'm back now. We're joined by Sean Astin and his wife, Christine, and daughter, Allie. Welcome, guys, to the premiere of The Hobbit, The Desolation of Smaug.
Yeah, I'm pretty, Smaug, huh?
Yes, I was told specifically, and you'll see when you see the movie.
I know, I'm Smaug to me.
That's what everyone's saying, but it's wrong.
But that's right. No, yeah, man. Wow, it's good to be back at the Kodak with Peter Jackson.
Well, this is like a reunion for you in a way with so many of these people.
It is. I just saw Dan and Chris Hanna, the production designer, and you know, who I grew up with from when I was 16 in New Zealand, and then through The Lord of the Rings, and they look the same, and the movies are getting even cooler, so what are you going to do?
So now, obviously, as many people know, Legolas, who was not necessarily in the Hobbit book, is back in this movie.
What?
What's up with Samwise? Why couldn't Samwise finagle himself into the movie?
Well, it's not over yet.
Oh.
You just sent all the fans into a tizzy. Are you in the last movie?
No, I'm not in the last movie.
All right. Well,
no, you know what I wanted to do when they first started to do The Hobbit? I thought, I want to play Gaffer Gamgees. I want to play Sam's dad. But I don't know. I didn't see any spot for him in the first one, so I'm looking close.
I'm not giving up on you. Have a great time. Nice to meet you guys. That's very cool. I like that. It's great to see people. Great to see people who are supporting this movie, even though they might not necessarily be in it. Oh, now this is cool. We've got Ed Sheeran. Ed Sheeran, who wrote the theme song. Hey, Ed. I'm Dave. Nice to see you. You doing all right?
Yeah, good. How are you?
I'm great, thanks. So I got to see the movie yesterday, and you wrote the song I See Fire that plays over the closing credits, and it's a very powerful moment when your song begins. What are you hoping your song will achieve as it plays?
Well, not to give too much away about the film, but it's a very intense ending, and I hope it just eases people back into non-Hobbit land.
Do you have any favorite songs that were written for movies that you wanted to hope this was as good as?
It's totally different, but a lot of Randy Newman's songs for Toy Story and stuff like that. I kind of like, yeah. I mean, it is totally different, but I wanted to make a song that would be remembered with the film rather than just cast off.
I love it. Well, we've got a couple good friends in common, so I'm happy to meet you tonight. And have a great time tonight, all right? Ed Sheeran wrote and performed I See Fire, the theme song from The Hobbit, The Desolation of Smaug. It's a beautiful song. I think people are really going to love it a lot. Stick around. We've got a lot more action here from the black carpet. So we'll be right back. Dave Karger back here live on the official live stream on the black carpet of The Hobbit, The Desolation of Smaug. I'm joined by Luke Evans, one of the new characters in the movie, Bard. It must be very exciting when you got that phone call that they wanted you to be a big part in this film.
It was an email, actually. I've got to say hello to my mum and dad who are watching at home back in South Wales.
Fantastic.
And Mo as well, if she's worked out how to log on to the live stream. Yes, it was an amazing moment to get that call, and I can't believe it's all done. And finally, after 2 years, I'm standing here talking to you, and I'm just about to watch it for the first time.
Oh, you haven't seen it yet?
I saw a little bit, but I haven't watched the whole thing yet.
Great. I've got a fan question for you. Oh, actually, Amy, my co-host across the street, has a fan who's dying to ask you a question. Oh, okay. Amy, take it away.
He has a question for you. What would you like to ask?
Hi, Luke. I'm Daisy from Utah.
Hey, Daisy.
Hi. I wanted to ask, if you could be any character in the original Lord of the Rings trilogy, who would you be?
Ooh, that's difficult. Let me think.
You've stumped him.
I don't know. Oh, God. I mean,
that's tough.
It's a tough one. I guess I'm quite fond of the old Aragorn character. I think if I'd have been around in those days, I'd have give Viggo a run for his money.
I'll tell you one thing that's very cool, and people will see when they watch this movie, unless they know about the character already. You're quite the archer in this film.
I'm quite the archer, yes.
And between this movie and The Hunger Games, it's like all about archery at the movies right now. Yes. What's that about?
Well, it's a cool weapon. It's a very old weapon, and it looks great. You know, it gives such a great profile when you're pulling it back, and when you get it in target, you know, you feel quite proud of yourself.
Here's another fan question from Vitch. Well, I'm not going to say the rest of that because it's like a bad word. I'm not going to say
okay,
that.
No,
but he or she wants to know, what's the hardest challenge in playing Bard?
The hardest challenge, I guess, is making sure that you get to see all sides of Bard, not just the hero. You want to see the family guy, and I wanted to make sure that all those different aspects of him were in his character and that they relate to the audience. And so that was a challenge the whole way through, because otherwise he can just be the bowman. But he's many more things than just the bowman.
He's a dad.
He's got three kids in this movie. He's a widow. He has very little, but he seems to survive. He's a survivor. I wanted to make sure that all of those things were shown in his character.
Well, Daisy from Utah across the street with Amy has another question for you, so let's send it back to her. Daisy.
All right, I'm going to let Daisy ask one more. What do you got?
All right, so if you could live anywhere in Middle Earth, where would you choose?
Oh, come on, the Shire. Of course, it'd have to be the Shire.
I would probably choose that too, so good answer.
Yeah, I'd probably have to put quite a few of the beds together to be able to sleep in one of the Hobbit beds, but I'd like to live in the Shire. It'd be very nice.
Okay, and here's another question from Costina Temple. What do you like most about Bard, and what's your favorite scene from the movie?
What I like about Bard is that when the crunch comes to the crunch, he pulls it out of the bag and does things that even he doesn't believe he can do. That's a true hero, and that's what I love about him. He's a man of many talents, and he's a humble man, but when he has to be the hero, my God, he does the hero thing. And my favorite scene, my favorite scene in the second movie will probably be that beautiful scene when I'm sailing them into Lake Town for the first time and through the mist, you just see Lake Town appearing, and then all of a sudden it pulls back and shows the enormity of this rickety old sinking town, which was my home for a very long time.
So what's next for you? What are you working on right now?
I've just wrapped Dracula Untold for Universal Pictures, and that was a great experience. I'm a little bit tired now, I have to say. And I'm preparing to start The Crow in the beginning of next year. So busy, 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 busy.
Very exciting stuff. It's great to see you, Luke. Have a great time tonight.
I hope you enjoy the live stream. I hope you logged on. Otherwise, I've just said hello to people that weren't watching.
Have a great time. We've got a lot more coming up here, so please stick around. We'll be right back.
Traction on the web right now. Let's read a couple tweets. Oh no, I'm supposed to be studying for finals, but I have to watch this live stream. Oh no, problems. Don't fail your final. No sleep tonight in Estonia. It's 4:30 a.m. Thank you for watching all the way across the world. Keep those tweets coming, guys. Who do you guys want to see most? Benedict Cumberbatch, get in line, y'all. Whoa, getting sassy out there. Hashtag Hobbit premiere. We'll be reading these all night. Let's toss it over to Dave and see what's going on the black carpet.
Thanks, Amy. Now I'm joined by probably the two luckiest people at this entire event, Melody and Jared, who are the fan winners of the contest that brought you here to this event. Tell me how you entered and how you found out that you won.
It was on Facebook. It was an Air New Zealand competition. Had to watch a little Hobbit video and answer a couple of questions. And only found out 2 days ago we'd won. And we're here now from New Zealand.
So 2 days ago you were back home in New Zealand and now you're here.
Actually, I was in Australia, but yes. Yeah.
Oh my God. And what went through your mind when you found out?
Is this for real? Yeah.
So how did you make believe that it was legit? You knew?
Yeah, I got an official email an hour later, but after the first initial phone call, but yeah, rang Melanie straight away and asked her what she was doing Monday, if she wanted to go to LA. So yeah.
And of course I said yes.
So how did you decide what to pack?
That's a very good question. We only had a couple of days to decide, so it was, you know, just a last minute thing.
We didn't pack a lot, to be
fair. No, we thought we'd save some room in our suitcases for a spot of shopping in LA.
I love it. Well, you're going to have a great time. You're going to have a great time with the movie. It's fantastic. So congratulations. Have
Thank
fun.
You very much.
Well, Martin Freeman, Bilbo himself, has entered the carpet. He has landed. He is here, just moments away from talking to me. So stick around.
The Desolation of Smaug. In theaters December 13. Experience it in IMAX 3D.
Hey, Dave Karger back with you on the black carpet premiere of The Hobbit, The Desolation of Smaug. I'm very happy to be joined by Philippa Boyens, one of the co-writers and co-producers of all of The Lord of the Rings and all of The Hobbit films. Welcome.
Oh, thank you. It's great. This is amazing. It's so good to be here.
We are running right now live on the official Hobbit YouTube and Facebook pages. Is there anything you want to say to all of the Hobbit fans who are watching right now?
Yeah, I wish you guys could be here. We're really proud of this movie. Enter the dragon. What else can I say? It's so exciting.
Indeed. Now, you and your collaborator, Fran Walsh, it sounds like the two of you are the ones who are really in charge of keeping all the characters straight, keeping all the plot straight, keeping all the minutiae in order with all the films. Is that true?
Yes, that is true. Although I have to say, Pete keeps a pretty close eye on us. But he did, he does let us sort of play around with stuff. And sometimes he says, okay, that's enough. Stop changing things.
We got a great question from a Facebook fan named Cassidy Rouge. A question for you. Cassidy. I love this question. She says, what was an easier movie to make, The Two Towers or this one? And she's curious because both are the middle films in their trilogies, and they're traditionally the hardest ones to make.
I think that's a great question, and Cassidy, can I tell you that I, The Two Towers is one of the films I'm most proud of having written in my entire life, and this one I think was easier because we'd been through The Two Towers and having written that. So yeah, I feel like touching wood. I'm going to touch wood.
You should.
I think there's a wooden box down there, and
I think people are going to love it. Well, Philip, I hope you have a great time tonight. Pleasure to meet you.
Yeah, I hope everybody enjoys this. It's great. It's a great atmosphere here. Thank you.
Thanks so much. Amy, let me send it across the street to you. What's going on where you are?
Wow. Well, Peter Jackson just came over to meet with some fans. So he's right behind us signing autographs. Oh, Evangeline Lilly was over here for quite a while. She took a lot of time with the fans. It's really great to be over here feeling this energy, being a part of this. All of these fans are so excited to meet the celebs, the stars, of course, the director, the writer right here, Peter Jackson in the flesh. What a cool moment for me to be in the thick of all of this. So I am so proud to be the eyes and ears of the fans and to be able to feel this right along with them. Evangeline making her way to the carpet. She looks absolutely stunning in that high ponytail. I'm sure she'll be making her way to you, Dave, in just a few minutes. But yeah, so much excitement here tonight on the black carpet. Dave, what's going on your end?
Well, I am told, Amy, that Dean O'Gorman and Aidan Turner, who play the brothers, Feely and Keeley, they're here. In fact, I can see them out of the corner of my eye. They're getting their photo taken right now. And I love the fact they actually like to do their interviews together, which makes a lot of sense since they have such a brotherly bond in the movie. And actually, Evangeline Lilly, we can see she's signing some autographs for the fans right now. And I'm very curious to see what the reaction is to her, because as many people know, she's a new character. Tauriel was a character that was invented by Peter Jackson and the filmmakers for this film. She doesn't appear in The Hobbit. In fact, no female characters appear in the actual book, but she's a character that was invented for the movie. So I think she's a little bit nervous to see how the hardcore fans react to her role. I think that when the fans see it, they're going to like her, because she has a lot of great heroic moments, and she really knows what she's doing. So I think she gives a great performance. But there's a lot of great other stars coming down the carpet right now. I can feel Feely and Keeley approaching me. I can feel their brotherly energy. So just hang around. I'll be right back with you.
gonna be December 13th already. I know these fans wish it was. Everyone is dying to see this movie. I can't wait to see what Mirkwood looks like. My favorite place, Hobbit premiere. So much fun stuff going. I wish I could be there at the black carpet premiere of The Hobbit, but we're bringing it to you all across the globe right here on the web. So keep sending your questions in. I've got so many excited fans right behind me waiting to see their favorite stars. Of course, Peter Jackson's still out here signing autographs. He'll make his way over to the other side of the carpet and to you, Dave, in just a couple of minutes. But we're going to keep reading your tweets all night long, so keep sending them in, guys. Back to you, Dave.
All right. Thanks so much, Amy. I can feel Dean O'Gorman and Aidan Turner. They're right over my shoulder. I'm going to try to bring them over right now. Oh, they're still greeting some people. So I'm just going to continue to talk more about them. What's really cool about the two characters they play is that they really seem very protective of each other. And there's a certain part in the movie where they get separated from other dwarves. And it kind of deepens their bond even more. I'm not going to say any more than that. But it's a really fun relationship to see, because it's clear that they care so much about each other. Oh, here they are, Aidan Turner and Dean O'Gorman. You guys are live on the YouTube and Facebook pages for The Hobbit. Welcome.
Thank you very much.
Feely and Keely themselves. I want to know how you guys forged the brotherly bond that you have in this movie. Did you able to hang out a lot together?
Work. We really hate each other. So
yeah, it took a long time to figure out that we're okay.
2 years later, we're still struggling a little bit with it. But we're getting there. We're getting there.
So who has to look after the other one more? I feel like, well, in this movie, I feel like...
Life? No, in the movie. in the movie, definitely my job is to look after this one, because he's a bit, younger and reckless.
Right. You're also involved in a little bit of love triangle.
There's, you say triangle, there's only two of us involved. Who's the third person?
A love line.
Bloody hell, I didn't know you were...
Legolas.
Maybe so. He's not fully aware of that yet. But there's something going on. It's a more flirtatious sort of thing for right now. Maybe we'll see what happens in movie three.
Well, I hope you guys have a great time tonight. It's a pleasure to meet you. You look fantastic. I love the suits, too.
Thank you.
Dean O'Gorman, Aidan Turner, Feely and Keely. And here's Martin Freeman himself. Bilbo Baggins. Hello, Martin. I'm Dave Karger. How are you? Nice to see you.
Yeah, all right.
Welcome to Los Angeles.
Thank you.
Now, I think what is going to impress a lot of people about this second film is that even more so than the first, we're seeing Bilbo the action hero this time. Was that fun to play?
Yeah, it's always fun to play something else. The Bilbo of the first film was slightly reticent, well, more than slightly reticent, not very adventurous. And we pick him up at a time where he has to do or die, so to speak. He has to save his and his friends' lives. And, it doesn't mean that he's Arnie, but it does mean that he's in a different kind of mode of behavior. Yeah, yeah, it's good.
We've got a lot of excited friends across the street who want to ask you a question, so I'm going to send it across the street to Amy. Amy, who you got?
We've got Carrie Ann here with a question for you, Martin. What would you like to say?
Hi, Martin. Thank you so much for taking a picture with me like 3 minutes ago.
Oh, yeah, you're welcome.
And my question is, I was wondering if there are any set pranks while you were filming the movie.
Any on-set pranks?
On-set pranks? Yeah, loads. Loads.
Oh, were you playing them or were they played on you?
I like to play, not even pranks, I just like to make Aidan Turner laugh. I see that as my job, is to make Aidan and Dean crack up, and it's like taking candy from a baby.
I love that.
It's very, very easy.
Okay, we actually have a lot of people who wrote in questions for you,
okay.
So I'm going to find one. From Julie Nelson 55, how was it to work with Benedict Cumberbatch again? Because, of course, you guys do Sherlock together.
Yes.
This is quite a different relationship from the Sherlock one.
Unfortunately, we didn't work together, I'm afraid to say. We were like Stevie Wonder and Paul McCartney in the Ebony and Ivory video. We never actually met, I'm afraid.
Well, which is cool, because you have a long scene together, which is, I think, one of the best scenes in the movie.
It's a good scene, eh? It's a good scene in the book, and I think it works very well in this. But no, we were both pretending, unfortunately.
Yeah. All right, Amy's got another fan with a question for you. Amy?
Social question from Brogan F. Wilson. Martin, what do you fear most about Smaug?
Smaug is a creature who could snuff me out in a heartbeat. He could kill me if he so chose. But also, as you see, there's a bit where Bilbo recoils from his bad dragon breath. And that's also something that's quite fearful about Smaug.
And how did they bring that across on set?
Well, no, that was just my imagination.
Oh, I see. Yeah. Right.
If I'm any judge, a dragon's going to have bad breath.
Now, do you think, because Bilbo uses flattery a lot to keep staying alive, and so Smaug doesn't kill him.
Yes.
Do you think he thought about that in advance, that this was going to be his tactic? Or do you think it's just something he came up with in the moment?
I think he didn't think of it at all. No, I think it's just pure terror. that's making him think, anything I can say that keeps me alive for another 30 seconds will be what I have to say. So no, I don't think it's pre-planned. He's thinking totally on his feet there.
One other thing that people are going to love in this movie is the sequence where you and many of the dwarves are basically floating down this river in barrels. Well, you're not actually in a barrel, but many others are. What was that like to film? Oh, someone is behind you.
Hello, John.
It's Stephen Fry. It's the master of Lake Town.
Yeah, how about that? With a proper beard. Now, the barrels was great. It was really, really good. It was fun. It was slightly dangerous.
I can only imagine.
You know, you're being dragged underwater into rocks. You know, that's never a good combination.
No. Yeah. All right, one last question for Mimi, then we're going to let Martin go.
Okay, any specific thoughts you can share on how you portrayed Bilbo's initial reaction to Smaug?
His initial reaction to Smaug is, I can't swear, can I?
Why not?
No, don't. No, don't. My initial reaction is, oh, heck, he's big. he's even bigger than I thought, because I'm just warned just before I go down. Balin says, listen, if you do see a live dragon, and I'm, sort of shocked by that. And then when I finally see the sheer size of him, it's mind-blowing and very, very scary. So, yeah, I just had to play fear a lot, yeah.
Well, I congratulate you on the film. I thought it was terrific, and I hope you have a great time tonight. Martin Freeman, Bilbo Baggins himself, have a great time.
Thanks,
Amy, let me send it back to you.
Well, the fans have lots to say about Martin Freeman. They love his portrayal of Bilbo Baggins in this film. Of course, we've got so many questions and just, you know, thoughts coming through. These are questions for Martin that we just asked. So, of course, you guys keep sending those hashtags in. I might be reading them live on the air tonight. We just saw Orlando Bloom came by and signed a bunch of autographs. I mean, it just is electric over here on Hollywood Boulevard tonight. Just so many actors coming across. So many people coming to say hello to the fans, which is very, very exciting to be in the thick of all this. Dave, you've got someone else over there, don't you?
I do, Amy. I am joined now by Howard Shore, who is the composer of this and all of the Hobbit films. I know they filmed most of the three movies together at the same time. Do you also do the score for all three films at the same time, or is it over a period of years?
I write over the period of 3 years, but each one is done separately 1 year.
I see. Yeah. Now, are you particularly excited for people to see it in this beautiful Dolby Theater tonight? Because it's going to be magnificent.
Yes, I'm anticipating a great screening.
Great. Well, I
hear the sound in this theater. Yeah.
Well, I congratulate you on a job well done. It's a beautiful score. Congratulations, Howard Shore, the composer of the film. And there's many stars still arriving here at the red carpet. Orlando Bloom is here. I think I just heard Amy talking about him. And there he is getting his photograph taken by all the paparazzi. And it's great to see him back because he, of course, was in the Lord of the Rings films and is now back as Legolas in the second Hobbit film, which I think a lot of his fans are very excited about. I also love that he's here because he's on Broadway right now in New York City in Romeo and Juliet. So I'm sure this being a Monday is his night off. So it's great that he was able to make it out here tonight for this black carpet premiere. But it's super exciting. I can feel like this is kind of the moment where the most activity is going on. I heard other screams, so I have a feeling, Amy, that maybe Benedict Cumberbatch might be in the house because I heard lots of screaming. You tell me.
I have not seen him yet, and what? I guarantee you that if he's here, I will know because there are lots of rabid fans in my immediate vicinity that want to see that man more than anyone tonight. So we're going to see him in just a couple minutes, but the fans are so excited. They're going crazy tonight. Let's check in with them and see what's going on. Let me see my mic. Dave, you have a special guest with you. Wait, who's over there?
Katie, my daughter.
Oh, fantastic. Yeah. I do have possibly the most special guest of all. I have the director of the film, Peter Jackson, along with his daughter, Katie. Welcome, Peter. Welcome, Katie.
Thank you very much.
What do you think of your black carpet premiere?
It's fantastic. I mean, I didn't realize it was a black carpet until you pointed it out. The flash bulbs are a bit too blinding.
So now you're both in the movie, right?
Yeah.
I saw you.
Yeah.
Yeah, for sure. In similar places, actually.
Yeah, Katie's a bartender. Oh, a barmaid.
Well, here's a question we have. The Facebook fans are asking tons of questions for you. When you were casting this film, did you have certain qualities and images in mind that you wanted your actors to meet before you hired them? That's from Renee Alderman.
You mean about casting myself, or are we talking about other actors now?
All the other people that you
boring.
Cast.
Yeah, okay, boring. No. We're mainly guided by Tolkien's book, and we also want to cast really great actors who feel right for the role, and also cast nice people, because you've got to be down in New Zealand, part of our family for 18 months, and so we do try to cast people that can be there for the long haul and be and have the right spirit. And we had a fantastic cast.
Here's a question from Alex Brown on Twitter. I like this one. How does it feel to know that you've inspired another generation to discover and experience The Hobbit?
Well, it feels great. I mean, it is one of the things about whatever liberties people say we take with the books, which obviously we're adapting the books for cinema. If it makes people read Tolkien's original books, then that's a great thing as well. And hopefully we're also inspiring young people to make movies as well, I hope.
My co-host Amy is across the street with a fan who would love to ask you a question. Amy?
Hi, Peter. I'm here with Nicole. She has a question for you.
Hi, Peter. I am a up-and-coming film major. I just had a quick question. Are there different directorial styles or techniques you use in The Hobbit that differ from the original Lord of the Rings trilogy?
I don't think so. I mean, I wanted to be the same filmmaker going back to Middle Earth again. I didn't want it to feel different. I mean, I might be different because I'm 10 years older. Might be a little bit more slow and creaky, maybe. But no, I mean, what's actually interesting is we shot the movies kind of in sequence. And so I think with the second movie, you do get a sense of me finding my rhythm a little bit and heading towards the climax. So it's actually, yeah, I mean, it's a long shoot, and I was getting into the gear by the time we shot the second film.
Well, Katie and Peter, I hope you guys have a great time. It's going to be a really fun night. So well done. Great to see you. So, yes, that obviously has to be the highlight. I mean, this is the guy who's responsible for all the reason that we're all here tonight. So, Amy, you get the sense that the fans are really excited about Peter Jackson over there?
Are you kidding me? The fans are so excited about Peter Jackson. I mean, he is the creator of this visionary world, brought it to life for them. He's the reason that these films are so beloved, and they are just so excited to see this film, and they were excited to meet the man behind the masterpiece. So yes, there is so much excitement. And Dave, you've got another guest over there.
Okay, Hobbit Facebook, here we are.
Well, now I'm with Evangeline Lilly, who plays Tauriel.
That's right.
I'm trying to pronounce it correctly. That's how Orlando says it in the movie.
You did it pretty well. It's Tauriel.
Tauriel.
Perfect.
This is a really great character because she's a woman who really can stand her ground and stand on her own and defend herself and other people. I imagine she was super fun to play.
She was super fun to play. Tauriel is not only powerful but incredibly compassionate, and all of her sort of acts of great heroism come out of her compassion, and that's what I think has made her the most. I think she's a beautiful character because of that, her big heart.
There's a fan across the street with my co-host Amy who's got a question for you. Amy?
Great. Hi, Evangeline. I'm here with Leanne. What would you like to ask, Evangeline?
Hi, Leanne.
I just wanted to know what was more physically demanding, The Hobbit or The Lost?
What was more physically demanding?
That's a good question, because Lost was sort of like a marathon and The Hobbit was more of a sprint. And so I had to work really hard on The Hobbit for a short period of time, harder than I had to work over, you know, 1 year on Lost. But when you take all 6 years of Lost and you put them together and the amount of endurance it takes to work in the sand in the jungle year after year, it's kind of a bit of a tie, I think.
Well, I hope you have a great time. Have a great time tonight. It's a pleasure to meet you.
Thank you very much.
Evangeline Lilly, Tauriel, now we know how to pronounce it. Everyone is coming fast and furious. I see that Benedict Cumberbatch, by the way, has made his way to the carpet. Orlando Bloom is over my shoulder. It's definitely getting quite busy here. This is definitely kind of the high point of the proceedings. Amy, what's going on where you are?
I am still in the middle of the fans. I am feeling the energy and the love that they are just radiating to their favorite stars tonight. I know they want to see Benedict very badly, so if you can send him on over, I know we'd have a lot of happy fans from around the globe. There he is right now. Look at how dashing he looks in that suit. Did you see the guns on Evangeline? That girl works out. She definitely earns her part in these very physically demanding roles that she's been playing as of late. But yes, the excitement is here. The fans are super stoked. They can't wait to see Benedict. So again, please send him across the street. We'll have more fan questions coming from the social platform in just a few minutes, and we'll check in as soon as we can. But what's going on over there, Dave?
Well, I'll tell you what's going on over here. I've got Orlando Bloom right behind me. In fact, he's turning around. There he is. Hey, Orlando.
Hello, how are you?
Dave Carger. Nice to see you.
Nice to see you, Dave.
So you got to be like the fastest trip of all the people in this cast, because you're in New York right now.
I am, yeah. I'm on Broadway. So I we had the Thursday off for Thanksgiving. We did two shows on Wednesday, two shows on Friday, two shows on Saturday.
Romeo and Juliet.
On Thursday, and I just jumped on a plane. And I'm so happy to be here. It's amazing, you know. It's such an event, these movies. It's been 10 years since I've been at a premiere for these. Lord of the Rings was... at least 10 years ago, and so it feels great.
Had you kind of given up hope that you would ever get to play Legolas again?
It wasn't so much giving up hope. I hadn't ever entertained the idea that it would happen because, of course, he's not really supposed to be in The Hobbit. But when Pete mentioned the idea, I was, of course, you know, very excited. And I think that Pete really kind of understands these worlds, and he's obviously, you know, knows how to make these movies really work. So it felt like we could make it authentic and work for the film to have Legolas in there, especially seeing as my father was in it, you know. So
it fits pretty seamlessly, if you ask me. Here's a question from Twitter. Brogan Francis, is Legolas different in The Hobbit than he was in Lord of the Rings? He looks older.
He looks, yeah, he's a little different in that, you know, I think that, I guess my experience from working has changed, but he's a little looser in a way because, I mean, it's a very nice story development into Lord of the Rings, but I think that, you know, the journey that he goes on, the sort of, is more kind of his world, because he's in his world more, he's in his habitat. So there is, I think people, I haven't seen the movie, so I can't really comment, and that's the one of the things, the great things of working with Peter is you don't really know, but I think people will be pleased to see it.
A fan across the street with my co-host Amy has a question for you. Let me send it over across the street.
Hi, Orlando. Genevieve here has a question for you.
Hi, Orlando. Hello. I was just wondering, does the wig still fit?
Yes, the wig still fits, which was very exciting. I actually, funnily enough, when I did Lord of the Rings, I had to shave my head. I had a mohawk. But I guess as I'm getting older, my hairline is raising slightly, so they didn't need to shave me into a mohawk. So, but it still fit, which was great. So obviously my head hasn't grown too much. So my ego hasn't got out of control. I was quite relieved.
Well, I hope you have a great time. I love that you're going to see the movie for the first time tonight. You're going to like it a lot. It's really good.
I hope so. It's great.
Orlando Bloom.
Thank you very much.
Great to see you. Amy, I'm sending it back to you.
All right. Well, we've got so many fan questions coming in from across the globe. I know people are watching in Greece. You're watching in Estonia. Please keep these coming so I can read them out loud. Let's see. Here we go. Epicness everywhere. Greetings from Greece. I'm getting chills from this Hobbit premiere. We love it. We're getting chills out here, too. Back to Dave, who's got someone live in the flesh. Who's over there, Dave?
Are we live streaming now? Well,
hey, Amy, I am now lucky enough to be joined by Benedict Cumberbatch. I know you're a little jealous right now, and we're all admiring the outfit. We love this. You look great.
Thank you very much. It was a bit of wonderful Dolce & Gabbana, and in the kind of Smaugian colors, so I thought it would suit for tonight's event.
Now, in the movie, you do the voice of Smaug the dragon, as well as the necromancer.
Yeah.
And so my question to you is, how is the Smaug voice different from the voice of your Alan Rickman impression? Because I love your Alan Rickman.
It's a little different. You have to see the movie to find out. But, you know, I did the voice and I did the motion capture for it as well. So yes, there's elements of the physicality that I did in that as well as the voice. It was an amazing, amazing job to have.
We have a question from a fan across the street. So let me send it to Amy, who's going to be very excited to see you too.
Hi, Benedict. I'm here with Mary, and she has a question for you.
Hi, Mary.
I was wondering how long you're in the studio to do the voiceover. Like, how long did it take to do the voice
of the
dragon?
We started off by doing motion capture. So I was there for about 2 days doing that for both the dragon and then the necromancer. And then, it's that camera, isn't it? I'm looking.
Yeah,
right. Okay, right. Then there were another sort of 4 sessions in the studio just purely for voiceover work as well. So, oh, you're changing cameras. Now you're there. Sorry, I didn't know that. It's crazy. It's like being in a TV studio. It was long, and it was hard work, but at the same time, nothing like the amount of work that everyone else put into this film. I kind of came in and did the sort of, well, had the maximum amount of input with the minimum amount of effort, which is it's a nice way to roll. But overall, I think it was about 8 days, if that, that I put into both characters, the necromancer I play as well as the dragon Smaug. So it was a lot of fun, though, a lot of fun.
Well, what they did with your voice, I saw the movie yesterday. The room shakes when you're getting angry. It's great to see and great to hear. So good. Many congratulations.
And to see as well. I keep on saying this. I did the motion capture as well. So a little bit of what you see of the dragon of the animation, the incredible job that the boys at Weta did is also me. So. Yeah, I'm very proud of that as well as the voice.
Well, congratulations on the film and on an amazing year when you think of Fifth Estate, Star Trek, 12 Years a Slave, August Osage County, which is so great. It's been such a great year for you, so congrats. Great to see you.
Lovely to meet you.
All right, take care. Amy, what's going on across the street?
Well, funny you should ask, because I'm about to give away a pair of tickets to a couple of lucky fans. We're just searching high and low for the people to give them away to. So that's going to go down in just a second. Actually, I'm about to award... Genevieve, get over here. She got to ask Orlando Bloom a question tonight, and now she's going to go inside and watch the movie. Are you excited?
What? Are you lying?
I'm not lying. You look at what's in your hand. What does it say? The Hobbit, Desolation of Smaug premiere. You have two tickets, honey. Are you excited?
This is the best day of my life.
Aw, get over there. You're going to miss the movie.
Oh, my God. Thank you.
Hold on one second.
Sorry.
It's my fault. Sorry. I told you to go. How exciting is this right now?
I've loved the Lord of the Rings franchise, like, ever since I was little, and now, like, they've done it all over again with The Hobbit, and just, it's the best thing ever, and I'm like, I missed class to be here. I'm a bad Asian.
Well, I've got someone here who wants to congratulate you on your win. This is Richard Armitage, who plays Thorin Oakenshield.
Hey, you're a good Asian. Congratulations for your win.
Oh, my God.
You look for him inside the theater.
Okay,
good luck when you get in there. Thank you so much.
Thanks, Amy. Richard, one thing I love about this second movie is that Gandalf is kind of off on a secret mission for part of the film, which means that Thorin Oakenshield is kind of the leader in a way. That must be fun to play.
It is. It's one of the few occasions where Thorin actually gets to take the reins. You know, he always has to defer to Gandalf. So when Gandalf disappears for a large portion of the movie, Thorin really gets to screw up in the best way possible.
Yeah. Here's a question from a fan on Facebook. What scene are you most excited to see tonight on the big screen?
I think the finale of the first film, which was actually created, the finale of the second film, which was created because there were originally we were just two films. So the dwarves face Smaug inside the mountain and try to destroy him. And I'm really excited to see that in all its glory. It's the most terrifying, fearsome beast, but it's so incredibly beautiful.
And I think people are also going to love the sequence in the barrels where you're riding down that river. Well, have you seen that finished yet with all the different elements put together?
I have, and we shot that in so many different pieces. We were floating down the Polaris River with this incredible current, and then in what was like a washing machine powered by V8 engines, which can only be described as a fairground ride. So many different elements that made up the barrel sequence. So really exciting to see that.
Do you have friends and family here with you tonight, or are you on your own?
I've got quite a few friends and family, but a lot of them are coming to Berlin. My entire family's coming to Berlin, so that'll be something to look forward to.
Here's another question from a fan. If you could play any other character in Tolkien's world as Legendarium, who would it be and why?
I have to say, I think it would be Smaug. I think I would like to actually physically become that beast. There's a moment in the third film where the essence of the dragon starts to infect Thorin, I don't know, I'd really like to experience what it's like to be a quadruped and fly and breathe fire, so yeah.
Smaug. What would your Smaug sound like? That's pretty good.
Thank you.
There's also a great sequence where you guys basically have to play stoned. I mean, you kind of, there's this, in the Mirkwood Forest, all of these different fumes overtake you. That must have been cool to play.
Quite appropriate for the relaxation of the marijuana laws in America at the moment. I have no experience of that, so I had to use my imagination completely. But the forest was intoxicating the dwarves, and it goes into a very surreal moment in the movie.
Let me throw across the street to my co-host Amy, because she has a question for you from social media.
I do. I have a question all the way from Canada. The Metal Hobbit wants to know, what has playing Thorin Oakenshield taught you?
What has playing Thorin taught you?
I think it's taught me to own a sense of humility and honor. I think it's taught me to question my own judgments as well, because Thorin goes through quite a process of looking at himself and changing because of Bilbo Baggins, and I guess I've done the same thing.
Well, I hope you have a great time tonight and in Berlin at the next premiere. Richard, great to meet you.
Thank you so much. Nice to meet you.
All right, now I want to show you some footage from an event that actually took place a couple of nights ago for a book called The Book of New Zealand. So take a look.
We are about to experience a unique merging of the fantasy of Middle Earth and the reality that is a slice of heaven, New Zealand.
Tonight is the opening of a Tourism New Zealand event called the Book of New Zealand.
They've recreated the film sets here, which is super cool.
You see these fantastical landscapes, and they look like they're really too good to be true, but you know, when we were down on location filming The Hobbit, they were places that I had never seen before, and I've lived in New Zealand all my life, and they still really took my breath away.
It's just a magical place. It has a very sort of natural, raw, beautiful feel about it. It's unspoilt.
There's such a great variety of stuff to see in New Zealand, from fjords to mountains to wide open spaces.
We're here for Tourism New Zealand and sort of letting everyone know how amazing New Zealand is.
Paradise was something else. It was very otherworldly.
You know, normally you think if you call paradise, you couldn't really live up to it. But actually, it's
stunning. Yeah, this country, it's too beautiful. And this coming from an Irishman, it's really stunning.
Paradise was probably, for me, the standout location that shocked me with its beauty.
I had an amazing time in the winter because I skied in the North Island and the South Island at Mount Ruapehu in Queenstown. So I would say come during the winter and enjoy the danger sports.
The Pelorus River is also special for me. I remember visiting that exact river when I was about 5 or 6 years old with my parents. All the way through the Lord of the Rings, I had it sort of logged away as a possible location, but there wasn't anything really suitable in that story. But The Hobbit, the barrels, the river, perfect use of the Pelorus River.
There are many reasons to come to New Zealand, and a lot of them are contained in this beautiful book.
Spent a long time there and put down a few roots, made amazing friends.
New Zealand is Middle Earth. It's become a fictional landscape that we know and love, but also it's a place where you can get on a plane and go visit, which is even more extraordinary.
It was wonderful. I loved working in New Zealand. It reminded me a lot of home.
We were really knocked out by A, the landscape, and B, the workmanship of the cast and crew on the film. And to be reminded of that tonight is fantastic.
I'm back here on the red carpet where the stars are still here, and now I'm joined by the master of Lake Town, Stephen Fry, also in from New York where he's doing 12th Night in the theater. Welcome.
Thank you. It's nice to be here.
Here's a question that I like from a fan named Hobbit and Proud. What is your favorite line that you say in the movie? You must have one. You have a lot of good ones.
Actually, I tell you what, it's a noise rather than a line. It's Peter and I decided that my character had really terrible digestion. So he was one of those people who couldn't help, when talking, just have this acid reflux. So Peter just does these take after take after take after take, and he'd say, okay, let's do one with a burp, and let's do one without a, like that. So it was just shoving in those noises there.
And your liver spots are very realistic.
I have hideous liver spots. I mean, my character is most disgusting. I'm not an oil painting to begin with, but once Rick Findlay, the genius makeup artist who looked after me, had finished with me with a ball cap and a comb over and scurf in my beard and liver spots, it's revolting.
But it works for the character. Listen, I know you need to get inside and see your movie, so enjoy your night. Thanks for stopping and talking to us, Stephen Fry, the master of Lake Town. Amy, let me send it over back to you.
Stephen Fry, revolting, but oh so charming. It has been my absolute pleasure to be here tonight at the Hobbit premiere, being the voice of the fans. So much fun, especially giving away those tickets. Thank you, Warner Brothers, and everyone. Enjoy The Hobbit. Thank you for having me. Good night.
And I also thank you all so much for watching. It's been an absolute pleasure to do this with you, Amy. And keep tweeting away with the hashtag HobbitPremiere. And don't forget, the movie comes out next Friday, December 13th, in theaters nationwide. You will not be disappointed. Thank you so much for watching the black carpet premiere of The Hobbit, The Desolation of Smaug. For Amy Paffrath and myself, Dave Karger, good night.
We've been blind. And in our blindness, the enemy is preparing for war.
You have no right to enter that mountain.
I have the only right.
It will not end here. With every victory, this evil will grow.
Unite the armies. Together you have the might and power to retake your homeland.
There's no dishonor in turning back.
No, I think I must try.
You awaken that beast, it will destroy us all.
There is nowhere to hide.
The Hobbit, The Desolation of Smaug. In theaters December 13th. Experience it.